Thank you, Thane. Thank you, Liz. Grace and peace to you in the name of the risen Christ. Good morning, Cathedral of Hope, United Church of Christ.
Good morning.
What a joy to welcome you on this Pride Sunday as we come to celebrate with the rest of our nation and the rest of this world that God is with us. And if God is with us, who can stand against us? Welcome to you as we gather for worship, each and every one of you. You look fabulous this morning.
Amen, amen. I concur, you do look pretty fabulous. This morning we want to welcome all of our first-time visitors. If you're here for the very first time, we want to welcome you into this space. We believe that you bring an image of the divine that we have not seen or encountered before, and that your presence blesses us, and we hope you will be blessed during this service. Immediately after our worship service, if you go back to the Ministry Center, we'd love to meet you, and we also give you a gift. It's one of our VIP mugs, just as a reminder that you are welcome in this place, and we celebrate you. Give a hand clap to all of our first-time visitors this morning.
As always, we want to extend a very special welcome to all those who are worshiping online with us today. We know that you have a choice when it comes to spiritual homes, but we are so glad that you've chosen Cathedral of Hope, United Church of Christ, to be your spiritual portal this morning. So welcome to each and every one of you, wherever you are in this world. Know that you are welcome. Please do let us know that you've been watching this morning in order that we might keep you in our prayers and thoughts. Cathedral of Hope, inside and outside the walls, let's welcome all those who are worshiping online with us today.
Well, it is summertime, and we are shifting along. If you have not picked up our summer edition of Shift Magazine, it's all of our programming options and classes and everything that we'll be doing over the summer. By all means, if you're going on holiday vacations, you can take one and give it to friends, neighbors, all those in your community, and let people know of all the things that are happening, all the things that God is doing here at Cathedral of Hope.
We want you to turn with us to pages 8 and 9 in your weekly, as you will find a lot more information about Cathedral of Hope celebrating 47 years of hope. Give yourselves a round of applause, Cathedral of Hope.
47.
And Michael, we'll be kicking off anniversary month next Sunday, there is a whole host of activities happening, as you'll see on these pages in your weekly today. Tell us about one of them, Michael, can you?
One of the things we're going to be having is bowling. If you are a bowler or if you're not a bowler, I'm not a bowler, and yet I'm going to the bowl-a-thon, and I'm hoping you will join me as well, and maybe we'll engage in a little friendly competition. You never know. But you can join us. You can see more information on page 8 and 9. And also, if you want to get your bundle tickets for a series of events and save a little money, we'd love for you to get those. I got mine. Reverend Neil, did you get yours?
I got mine.
And so we've gotten ours. You should get yours. You can see Patsy in the back. There are a host of opportunities,
That's very clever.
Speaking of hosts.
Yeah, there's opportunities to host a party at either your home or a restaurant or some other event that you want to be creative about. We're inviting you to invite people who perhaps sit on your pew. We know that we have some pew mates usually on Sunday mornings, perhaps to invite friends that have not been to Cathedral of Hope before and invite them to get excited about this, your congregation. These parties are an opportunity for you to brag on your church and to tell people about how wonderful Cathedral of Hope United Church of Christ is. If you'd like to host a party, please again visit the table in the narthex, and people will be there to mark your date and to help you in promoting your party and event. I said yesterday at the town hall meeting that, and don't tell Isaiah because he doesn't know this, but Isaiah and I will be hosting a party.
He's cooking, apparently.
Yeah, apparently he's cooking, yeah. So watch out for that. It'll be happening probably towards the end of July so that we don't interfere with other people's. But we'll be glad to welcome you to our house, and we will probably have to close down the whole neighborhood just to get you there. So we want to do our part. It really is important that we all do our part as we celebrate 47 years of hope here at Cathedral of Hope.
Absolutely. This week, you know, we have Sunday services. We also have Wednesday night services, and our Pulse series is continuing. It's on road trip. I believe that road trip was rest stops was last week. That's what it was. We're talking about our series for Wednesday nights. Our sermon series is called Road Trip, and we're going along and talking about all the things that God is doing in the midst of our lives, in the midst of a summer road trip, if you will. But our series continues this Wednesday at 7:15. We invite you to please come out. And as well, we have a celebration. Legacy Counseling's Legacy Award was given away last night to our own Reverend Dr. Neil Cazares-Thomas. In recognition of not only all the hard work that Reverend Dr. Neil has done, but also the hard work that this community continues to do in fighting HIV and AIDS and bringing awareness to help save lives and further the lives of so many in our community. So thank you, Neil.
Thank you. And I think I got some of the award for car karaoke this week. if you don't know what that is, you can check it out on Facebook. And of course, this week, Reverend Andrea will be doing her car karaoke. So you want to make sure that you like our page on Facebook so that you get to see that first. I think we had over 6,000 views of the car karaoke this week and more than 40 shares. I was reminded of that last evening. Raffle is benefiting our youth who are going on their youth mission trip. You can pick up raffle tickets in the fellowship hall, and you can find out more information about what you're benefiting on page 12 of your weekly. So we want to encourage you to support our youth, our next generation. They are the church just as Amen. Much as we are. So please think about helping to support the youth.
As well, in our Sources of Hope gifts and books today, there is a book signing. You can find more information about that on page 10 in your bulletin. You can purchase the book. You can actually get it signed. But please visit and support our local authors, and let's help one another in this community. And as well, we have a visitor from New England for the summer.
We do indeed. We are delighted that we have been chosen as the congregation of choice for one of our clergy intern for the summer, who's actually been with us already for about 2 weeks and will continue to be with us throughout the summer. We are glad to introduce to you this morning Denson Staples. Denson, why don't you come up and join us while I just read a little bit about your bio and just how incredible you are. Please welcome Denson. So a prestigious bio for someone so young. Denson Staples grew up as one of 8 kids in Houston, Texas.
Houston. H-Town.
Graduated with a high distinction from the University of Virginia with a Bachelor of Arts in Religious Studies and Global Public Health, with a graduate next year from Harvard Divinity School with a Master of Divinity. Yes, ooh. while at Harvard Divinity School, he has been involved in racial justice and healing initiative and LGBTQ rights. During his first year, he orchestrated the Queer Divine, a morning prayer sermon series at Harvard's Memorial Church. They didn't know what hit them. he was the recipient of the Massachusetts Bible Society Scripture Reading Prize and the Harvard Divinity School's 2017 Stednall Award for Excellence in an Academic Paper. Denson studies Islam, Christianity, and the use of scriptural resources for socio-political ends, particularly to make ethical and theological claims about sex, gender, and sexuality. After graduation, he hopes to pursue ordination in the United Church of Christ and doctoral work in the study of religion. He comes to Cathedral of Hope, eager to observe and learn more about reclaiming and proclaiming the radical possibilities for queer life found in the disruptive ministry of Jesus.
All right, all right.
A tall order. Let's welcome once again Denson. Please make sure that you introduce yourself to Denson so that he can remember all your names in the next 10 weeks. Friends, it's in that hope and love that we get to worship this morning. So let's rise and turn to one another and offer a sign of peace.
Holy and gracious God, we gather here as your people, our hearts open wide to those who gather beside us, who gather in this space ready to welcome and to worship you in our midst. In the name of Christ, the one we follow, amen. Amen. My friends, please be seated.
Our Hebrew lesson comes to us from the first chapter of Ruth. Hear these words. Naomi said to Ruth, "Look, your sister-in-law has returned to her people and to the God of her ancestors. You too must go. Follow your sister-in-law." But Ruth said to Naomi, "Please don't ask me to leave you and to turn away from your company. I swear to you, where you go, I will go. Where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people will be my people. Your God, my God. Where you die, I'll die there too. And I will be buried there beside you. I swear, may God be my witness and my judge, that not even death will keep us apart." Seeing that Ruth was determined to accompany her, Naomi said no more, and together they walked until they came to Bethlehem. May God bless the hearing of these ancient words. Amen.
Amen. How indeed can we keep from singing, and specifically on this day, this National Pride Day, when we're invited to sing perhaps literally, but also to sing from our hearts, to welcome others amongst us, and to define who is our neighbor. So on this Sunday, please join with me as printed in our order of worship as we celebrate and share this litany of pride. As wounded healers like Jesus, we have discovered a depth of compassion that is rooted in our pain and strengthened by our love. We are often the ones who care for the sick, the marginalized, and the weak. We thank you, God, that your compassion has inspired us to offer this gift to our world. Gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people press the boundaries of the status quo. We create the avant-garde, the ingenuous, the fresh. We question why things are the way they are, and then work to make them new and different. We thank you, God, that you have called us to join you in making all things new. From every walk of life, from every strata of the world, from every class and nation and race, we cross all categories of people. We indeed are the rainbow of the world. We thank you, God, that you have given us a gift of diversity and helped us to learn the true value of inclusivity. We are a deeply spiritual people. Our faith undergirds everything that we are and everything that we do. God has chosen us to minister healing and wholeness in our time and for all time. We thank you, God, for calling us to a deeper journey. Strengthen us by your Holy Spirit, that those who come behind us may find us faithful to this call. Amen.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Come, Holy
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, O God.
An expert on the law stood up to put Jesus to the test, saying, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus answered, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" And the expert on the law replied, "You shall love the Most High God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And Jesus said, "You have given the right answer. Do this, and you will live." But the expert on the law, seeking self-justification, pressed Jesus further, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A traveler was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers. The traveler was beaten, stripped naked, and left half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road. The priest saw the traveler lying beside the road, but passed by on the other side. And so likewise, a Levite came the same way. This one too saw the afflicted traveler and passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, who was taking the same road, came upon the traveler and, filled with compassion, approached the traveler and dressed the wounds, pouring on oil and wine. And then the Samaritan put the wounded person on a donkey, went straight to an inn, and there took care of the injured one. The next day, the Samaritan took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of this person, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend.' Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the traveler who fell into the hands of the robbers?" The answer came, "The one who showed mercy." Jesus replied, "Go and do likewise." This is the gospel of hope. Praise to you, Creator, Christ, and Holy Spirit.
Seated, and if you would open your hearts and your minds as I ask you generously to do every Sunday, as we ask Spirit to touch this word and to bring new life to us this day. Let us pray. God of all creation, who created all of humankind in your divine image, help us this day to celebrate the divine image that lives within each and every one of us. As we come before you with open hearts and with open minds and with a generous spirit, remind us, God, that we are your people this day, called as ambassadors to live by the values of the faith in which we declare that we see in Jesus. So be with us, God. Envelop us and develop us. And now, God, I pray that you would touch my lips of clay, mold them into the words that need to be spoken this day. And may the words that come from my mouth and the meditations on each and every one of our hearts, may they be ever acceptable to you. In the name of Jesus the Christ, in whom we pray. Amen. So today is LGBT Pride. And across the nation, there have been Pride festivals happening throughout this nation and indeed throughout the world. As people like you and I, not necessarily just LGBT people, but people like you and I as allies and standing alongside one another, have taken to the streets Now, of course, here in Dallas, we have to do things differently. Our pride doesn't happen until September. And I'm told that the reason why we don't celebrate Pride until September is because it is cooler in September. I believe it's a lie of the devil. It would make so much sense to have Pride today. And so here in our congregation, we round out the month of June by celebrating LGBT Pride as a congregation of the United Church of Christ, and a congregation that was founded in and moving beyond just the LGBT community. For those of you who don't know the history of Cathedral of Hope, we were founded nearly 47 years ago. In fact, we're just about to celebrate our 47th birthday. And we were founded out of the movement of those who were reclaiming their spirituality, who were reclaiming Christianity, who were redefining what it meant to be a people who were once not a people. A people who were claiming their heritage and were responding to some of the rhetoric that was existing within the church at that time, and has for many times excluded people from the dominion and realm of God. And there was a group of 12 folks here in Dallas, Texas, who said, enough is enough. That for me and for all people, there is a house of worship that should be for all of God's people. And that included God's LGBT people. A place where we could call home, a place where we could come and worship openly and freely, a place where we would expect the extravagant God to be present with us. And for 47 years, we have defined what it means to be followers of Jesus. We have redefined for the Christian church what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And for 47 years, we have bragged on this great love of God that embraces and encompasses all of God's people. And so on this LGBT Sunday, we don't just hang the rainbow flag. We don't just brag on who we are. We brag on what it means to be a follower of Jesus and to allow the presence of the Holy Spirit to live and move freely amongst us. We brag on the divine experience of a God who, in the face of some Christian churches, would say does not include us, and yet we see the wave of the Holy every Sunday as we come into this sacred space. I always say the proof is in the pudding. It's not necessarily in someone else's theology, it's in the way that we have chosen to embrace this God and to live this God in our world. And if God is able to bless us in those moments, then we know that God has surely been present and God is pleased with who we are. There are still so many in our world who do not believe that God could transform or God could be involved in those who are same gender loving. But every Sunday we step into this space and into many other spaces around the world, we define what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And through us, and sometimes in spite of us, God has a way of showing up. God has a way of surprising the human condition. And God has a way of redefining what it means to be those who are loved by God. In our scripture reading this morning, we heard Jesus confronting those same hypocrisies that have been experienced in the Christian church for these 2,000 years, and helping those early followers and those early believers to redefine and to define who is our neighbor. In order for us to fully understand the implications of what Jesus was teaching those disciples that day, we need to understand this story more fully than just the text that is on the page before us. The scripture tells us that there was this wise one who came to Jesus and said, "Tell me, how do I inherit eternal life?" It is that $6,000 million question that all of us have. How do we inherit eternal life? Now, Jesus could have gone into a thesis of theology and sat with him for the next 20 years to try and explain to this young one, this wise one, how does one inherit eternal life? But Jesus just referred him to the text of his own biblical knowledge. And one responded that the scriptures of the Torah and of the great revealings of the rabbis teach them that they must learn to love God with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength, and to learn to love their neighbor as themselves. And Jesus, as usual, responded, "You have spoken wisely. There is nothing else that you need to do to inherit eternal life. You learn to love God, love self, and love others." But as with all of us, we want to define the borders and the boundaries of who is our neighbor. Who is it that we have been called to love? It's easy to love God, whom we don't see. But how do we learn to love our neighbor? And how do we define who our neighbor is? And so in Jesus' great fashion, Jesus responds with this parable. And he says to them, there was this this one who was traveling on the road and who was discovered to be beaten, perhaps even in Oak Lawn. This one who was beaten and rejected and left on the side of the road. And Jesus says that this priest came along, not me. But this religious authority person came along, and I'm sure that just like me on a Sunday morning, dressed to the nines, don't want to get our robes dirty. Doesn't look good on camera. And in the busyness of the day and the busyness of rushing from one thing to the next, it's easy just to sometimes ignore the situations and the opportunities to be those of great compassion and care. And so it says that the priest saw the one who was hurt on the side of the road, but they walked by on the other side. Sometimes when we're on the freeways and we see those who are struggling, looking for a hand up, not a hand out. But sometimes it's easy for us to pretend that we're changing the channel on the radio. Or perhaps, like many of us these days, in those moments of stopping at traffic lights, we get our cell phones out just to see if we've had another like on Facebook. It's easy to move on by. And then it says that there was this Levite. Now, the Levites were those who were in charge of the temple. They were a special group of people. It says that there was a Levite that came and saw this one who was hurt on the side of the road, and in his busyness, he too walked by. Now, perhaps he thought that if he would touch this one who was hurt, that he would be unclean, and as a Levite priest, it was difficult for them to deal with this uncleanliness, and so they would have to go to the temple and go through a series of rituals in order to be clean again. And so it was easier just to walk on by on the other side. And then Jesus says that there was a Samaritan. Now, a Samaritan was a group of people who were rejected and despised by many. They were the in-between peoples. They were the people perhaps like you and I. The people who have not recognized by many of the religious authorities were seen as less than. And it says that Jesus came with this Samaritan. The Samaritan saw the one who was injured on the side of the road and had great compassion and great care and went over and ministered to this individual and did more than that. They went the extra mile, loaded this young one onto the back of a donkey and took him off to an innkeeper, gave the innkeeper money, said, "I'm going to go away," came back and made sure that this one had all that was needed. And the question that Jesus had for this religious leader, this one who was wise, who wanted to know how to inherit eternal life, he said, "And which one of these was the neighbor?" It was hard for him to deny that the one who was less than, the one that was cast out, the one that was rejected by many was the neighbor. Here we are today, Christians in this Cathedral of Hope, United Church of Christ, and we ask ourselves that same question: who is our neighbor? If our desire is to inherit eternal life, if our desire is to know God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength, it's not just about the knowledge of knowing, it's about how we live it out in the world. How do we encourage and encompass these values that God has given to us so that we might love our neighbor as ourselves? Love our Jewish neighbor. Love our Muslim neighbor. How do we love our neighbor as ourselves? It's not just good enough for us to come into sacred space on Sunday morning if this transforming moment in our lives doesn't give us impetus to travel into the world with grace and compassion and honor. It is but just then talking heads and not transforming hearts. We are called to love our neighbor as ourselves, and we don't get to choose who our neighbor is. We don't get to choose if the neighbor looks like us, or believes like us, or thinks like us. We only get to choose to reach out with hearts of compassion to whoever God might decide to put in our path. And to allow this Christian church, this community of faith, to struggle to embrace and to understand who is my neighbor. You know, we celebrate LGBTQ pride every single year, and we give God thanks for the allies and the straight folks that come amongst us and that we stand together in this. But for those of us who are LGBT, we too must struggle in our own community with who is our neighbor. In our own community, we still struggle with racism. In our own community, we still struggle with sexism. In our own community, we still struggle with transphobia. In our own community, we still struggle with loving ourselves. We are called to our better selves this morning on this LGBTQ Pride Sunday, to call to our better selves, to our better instincts, and to move to a place where there is true radical inclusion in the body of Christ. And if we can't do that, for those of us who have been rejected, despised, and sent away, been told by Southern Baptists and Salvationists and others that we are not worthy of God's love, if we can't embrace this radical conclusion, I truly believe that the Holy Spirit will move on and find another people who will. But God has called Cathedral of Hope, United Church of Christ, to this pioneering work of reclaiming Christianity, to redefine who our neighbor is, and to enable us to have a chance of fulfilling this great commission that Jesus gave to us, to go into all of the world and to baptize all people in the name of God, who is Creator, Jesus, who is our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, who is our Comforter. We have been called beyond the stereotypes, the borders, the margins, but beyond all of those things, in order that God's new realm might come here on earth as it is in heaven. I don't know about you, but that sends shivers up my spine. That we should be called to do this great pioneering work and to redefine what it means to love our neighbor. To allow all who would seek God's grace to come into this place. There is no doubt in my mind that Cathedral of Hope has transformed Christianity as we know it today. We have transformed Christianity as we know it today. We have been those ambassadors in the world. Many of you know that over this last year, I've been working with a group of evangelical clergy and been a part of a talking spot in Washington and in New York, helping specifically evangelical Christians, evangelical leaders, to begin the conversation of reclaiming Christianity and expanding their own ministry to include LGBTQ people. It is one of the great things that we get to do as Cathedral of Hope. And I know I stand in those meetings representing each and every one of you from our diverse walks of life. Those folks this past week, in celebration of LGBT Pride Month, released a video that I would like to share with you this morning. Please pay your attention to the screens for a few minutes.
Oh. I grew up without knowing that there was even the possibility of a gay lesbian person.
You know, as a heterosexual myself, I didn't really have those issues in front of me.
I don't know that I even knew these people existed.
The issue that was so predominant for our church as I was growing up, what was commonly called the gay issue.
I was certainly raised with a belief that homosexuality was a sin.
It was an abomination. An abomination was our fancy word for the worst of sins.
That I'm broken, they're broken, we're all broken in different ways, and this is their brokenness.
All we know is what the pastor teaches us. And so I recognize the fact that a lot of people just don't know. And a lot of pastors are just regurgitating what their previous pastors said.
What really changed for me was being in ministry.
Through the years pastoring, I obviously began to meet gay and bisexual and intersexed, queer, transgendered people. I don't remember any of them being the monster that I had abstractly been warned that they were.
As they actually embraced who they were and celebrated as something that God brought about as a part of God's miraculous variety, we saw really healthy lives, not lives falling apart. None of what I had been taught about this was fitting with the reality on the ground.
And I decided to do a Bible study on the topic of homosexuality. It was the first time in my life up to that point that I had ever studied the topic. I could quote scriptures about it. I could teach a sermon about it, but I never studied it like I study other topics.
The question is not, was the Bible wrong? The question is, did we read it properly?
We don't read the Bible tabula rasa, which means blank slate. We bring all of our family system into our reading of Scripture. We bring all of the social expectations that people have. These particular verses, and there's around six or so of them, don't seem to be addressing our situation at all. We've gotten stuck into ruts kind of assuming what they say, and we need to think more clearly.
Divinity school, I discovered that there was no reason to believe that God doesn't simply love everyone.
After I finally realized that these passages don't mean what most people say they mean.
None of these passages are describing what LGBT Christians are asking about today.
I knew at that point that my ministry had to change. That from then on, I would have to be a lifter of burdens instead of someone who tied them up.
Marriage is about a love that God has instilled in our hearts, and however we choose to express that love with another consenting adult, that God is okay with that, and we as the church, we're okay with that too.
I've actually changed my mind on this.
We have a long history of being wrong. Well, at the heart of a Christian hermeneutic should be humility.
You know, God created some of us this way, some of us that way, whatever that looks like. It's all good and it's all beautiful, and so how can we see dignity in that and make room for life in that expression?
This church then went on to officially vote to become an open, welcoming, and affirming congregation.
If it's going to be good news, it's going to be good news for everybody.
I look to the future with a great degree of hope. A change must be on the way.
A change must be on the way, and it begins with us. As we celebrate this LGBTQ Pride Sunday, a change is on the way, and Cathedral of Hope United Church of Christ, you are leading the way today. Stand with me as we celebrate 47 years of hope, as we begin and continue this move of change that the Christian church has been waiting for. Happy Pride. God bless you. Cathedral of Hope, United Church of Christ. Amen.
At the end of each pew and each row of chairs. As you are passing the pads, we ask that you think deeply about your own gifts and allow us to share our testimony about why we give.
I'm Jim Hamby. And this is my partner, Sam Pointis. We've been together 21 years. It was June 15th, 1996, that we had a holy union right here in this sanctuary.
Jim loves themed parties. In fact, that's how we met. It was an end of summer party. I guess you can say we'll probably be remembered as those pink flamingo guys, which we just recently hosted the 11th one prior to this taping.
Sam and I feel like our life has been blessed by this church, by God, and we're happy to support this church. We generously support this church. I never before experienced a church that had so many dedicated programs affecting people beyond the ones you see in the pews every Sunday. I want to tell you a story about a dear friend of ours, a straight friend. Babe attended the 9 a.m. service and was seated in the center aisle near the front. She was legally blind, could only see a blurry image from her good eye, and she also had a difficulty hearing and used our assisted hearing service. It costs a lot of money to operate a church this big. You have the utility bills, you have the expenses of good quality programs for us to follow, printed programs. You have the cost of those listening devices that Babe made use of. Those of you who are hearing our testimony today have got a duty to the people who are going to walk through our doors in the future, the people who are going to go to our website in the future. They may be gay or lesbian, struggling with their beliefs. They may be an elderly woman, unable to give but a widow's mite to support the church. We hope you too will give generously and discover the happiness that comes from enabling our church to be a vibrant, inclusive, and progressive institution.
Yesterday, at the town hall meeting, we learned some startling facts. One was that over half of you present today are going to give less than $5 to the church today. That was surprising to me. The other thing was, and you can see this on the staff listing on page 2, our staff has been reduced by 3 people because the giving has not been as good as it was. We could do so much more. If you believe this church really has this great opportunity and this great mission, then we need to be giving more to make it possible for this church to do that.
Thank you, gracious God, for moments of worship where we are clearly reminded of how much we have been given. It is easy to forget and to take for granted the God-given abundance in our lives, or to believe we are simply lucky or clever, giving God little credit for well-being. But here in worship, we are reminded that we are loved and blessed, and where that love and blessing comes from. Today, we express our gratitude by sharing our gifts and ask that they may be used to fulfill Cathedral of Hope's United Church of Christ's purpose in God's creation. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Amen.
Reminding me of all the times I've tried before and failed. The waves, they keep on telling me time and time again, boy, you'll never win. You'll never win. And the voice of truth says this is for my glory. Out of all the voices calling out to me,
calling out to me,
I will choose to listen and believe the voice of truth.
Oh, what I do to have the kind of strength it takes to stand before a giant with just a sling and a stone, surrounded by the sound of a thousand warriors shaking in their armor, wishing they'd had the strength to stand. But the giant's calling out my name and they laugh at me, reminding me of all the time we tried before and failed. The giant keeps on telling me time and time again, boy, you'll never win. You'll never win.
But the voice of truth tells me a different story. The voice of truth says do not be afraid.
As we come to this table today, remembering the narrative of Christ as he gathered in the upper room with his disciples, it is a narrative that we remember not only because we recall it every week, but because so often we live it every day. So many of us know what it means to be like the disciples, relegated to the upper room, to the bars and to the bathhouses, to those places where we could truly be ourselves. And as we gather here as a community of faith, we gather like the disciples did, bringing all that they were to that table, gathered with friends who loved them and who they loved, and who had their backs and who cared about them. And so as we share this meal, we remember that meal. We remember that night that Jesus took the bread and blessed it by giving thanks not only for the meal they were going to have together, but that they were having it together. And he broke it. And he said, "As often as you eat of this broken bread, remember me." And likewise, as we take the cup, we remember that night as Jesus poured it out for all of those who were gathered there, just as he pours it out for all of us who are gathered here. We remember him. We remember that he is with us and we are with him, and that we are all gathered around that sacred table.
Let us pray. Almighty God, send the power of your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of grape and grain. Make them be for us holy food that nurtures us in body and spirit, that by sharing this feast we may know the presence of the living Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all of the world. Through Jesus Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours now and forever. Amen. Amen.
Come just as you are, hear the Spirit call. Come just as you are, come and see, come receive, come and live.
ground, we stand and we give thanks that you have fed us with spiritual food and drink. Bless us now and remind us that as we love, the God of love is always with us. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Friends, as we prepare to go back out into this world, receive your pride. Pride in yourself, pride in your God, and pride in this, your church. And now, unto God's gracious mercy and protection, each and every one of us is given. And may the blessing of God, known to us as Creator, Savior, and Holy Spirit, be with us and remain with us now and evermore. Amen. Go in peace. Mm-hmm.